In today's digital world, where dangers lurk online, your personal information is readily available to anyone. This becomes a serious concern when someone starts to misuse it. Think about online stalkers blackmailing you with personal information, your images, text messages, sending random threats to your social media accounts, maybe your phone number, or to your relatives. Eventually, they may reach your home, which is the biggest threat. Removing that online information becomes almost impossible, so we need to rethink how we protect ourselves. What if lying could be our strongest defense? We're told not to lie, to always be honest, and to assume the best in people. However, when it comes to privacy and safety, you don't get many chances. Once breached, it can have long-lasting negative effects on your life. A little bit about me so you know where I come from when I talk about online privacy. I say this as an ethical hacker, a white hat hacker, the good guy who defends against malicious hackers or bad hackers. I come from a very technical background and use my skill sets and knowledge to help protect not only companies and organizations, but also individuals against people with malicious intent. Now, on to my weird privacy tactics. While they may be normal to me, they're not commonly understood by others. What inspired me to give this message to the youth was a situation I was in a few years ago where I lied in public in front of my kids. I was ordering food at a drive-thru restaurant. They asked me for my name, and I said Ali, which is not my name, of course. My daughter looked back at me and asked, "That's not your name. Why did you lie?" I thought about it for a second and saw it as a teaching moment. I explained, it's okay to lie in a situation like this to protect your privacy. I said, this is a person that I don't know and don't want to get to know. Why do I need to give them my name? Next thing you know, they'll ask for a phone number, and then they'll ask me to fill out some survey or a form with my home address in it. What if this person gets angry at me at something and comes knocking on my door because they know too much information about me now? Do you want to deal with that? It may be extreme, but that's how I give examples to my kids, showing them the repercussions. Immediately, she understood and agreed it's okay not to give out your name or any other personal information. A few months later, I saw her playing a popular game called Roblox, a game that many child predators often lurk on. I know this because I deal with a lot of online investigations. So as I sat next to her, I noticed her screen name was not her real name. It was something else. So I asked, "Who's that in your Roblox game?" She said, "That's me." Remember, we're not supposed to give out our true names to strangers. That was a proud dad moment for me. It showed that leading by example actually works. And kids learn very quickly. Their minds are like a sponge. The goal here is to spread awareness. There are countless dangers lurking online, like predators, stalkers, and future threats we may not be aware of today. Once they happen, it's kind of too late, and you can only do damage control at that point. I say the best way to start is to stalk yourself. Look yourself up online. You know best where to find you, and that will give you, you know, step one of understanding what's available out there. Once you've figured out your digital footprint, ask a professional, someone like me or, you know, someone in the tech industry, a tech-savvy friend, to really go deep and investigate. As an online digital investigator, I use a technique called open source intelligence, or OSINT for short. It's the skill of looking at freely and openly available resources online. There are hundreds of resources someone with ill intent could use to check your social media profiles, figure out your date of birth, your friends, where you live through pictures, your particular interests. There can be case files about you online, specifically if you have parking tickets or vehicle records. There are so many websites where you can put in someone's name and a whole bunch of information would pop up about them for free. These are called people search websites. Then there are breaches. Almost everyone's been in a breach. So there are many ways to look at someone and to use that information to exploit them. We need to be wary about these dangers, primarily stalkers using that information and people posting your personal information online to cause harm. This is known as doxing. Your personal information, like your social security number, your passwords, your family members' names, locations, can be used to blackmail you. If someone has your pictures or old messages, it can cause a lot of embarrassment, known as sextortion, where they hold those images against you and ask for money. There's a lot that can go wrong, but that's just the tip of the iceberg. As you dive deeper into how privacy can be abused, there are services where people can order poop online and have it delivered to your doorstep, for which they obviously need your home address to start off with. And that's something that is happening today, unfortunately. It's an annoyance, but this can go further into something called crime as a service, where people can brick your house. That's exactly what it sounds like. This is a service where someone can hire anyone anonymously online, pay them $50 and say, throw a brick at this person's house because I just didn't like the way they commented or I just don't like the person. There's not much you can do about it. Even law enforcement can't do much to stop these kinds of attacks. It can lead to pizza deliveries, annoying deliveries at your home. It can even get worse. There have been cases of swatting, where someone calls the SWAT team pretending to be you, knowing your home address, and saying something like, I'm about to shoot everyone here. Come get me. The SWAT team arrives at your doorsteps thinking someone else is going to shoot them, and they take you down, causing embarrassment at best. Or there have been cases where there have been deaths. So this can have detrimental effects and potentially destroying your life. This is where digital hygiene comes into play. You might say, just don't give out your true information. You're not wrong, but in our world, corporations make millions of dollars by collecting and selling your information to other organizations for the purposes of advertising, marketing campaigns, background checks, you name it. They have ways to monetize your information. And they'll use sneaky tactics by not telling you they're going to use it and abuse it, but they'll still collect it. So they use tactics of influence and get you wrapped around in providing more and more information, whether it's in the forms of conversation or online surveys. Saying no is not always easy. Just the other day, I went to the doctor's office and they asked me for my social security number. I almost gave it to them, but then I questioned them saying, why do you need it at all? Am I opening up a bank account here, or what do you want to do with my social? They said it was just for a unique identifier. I replied, my name and date of birth, which you already have, should be unique enough. Then they told me it was optional. I asked, why ask if it's optional, and refused to give any other optional information, and said, only ask me things that are absolutely critical for you to do business. Now, that took courage and some initial embarrassment to confront them with people around me. Most people would just give in. Saying no is not always that easy. What I do instead is create a couple of aliases, fake emails, fake addresses to give out when necessary. It's much easier to give made up information than to explain why privacy is so important and why I don't want to get doxxed or swatted. It's a time to rethink online safety. We need to lead by example and tell kids it's okay to lie to protect their personal information. White lies are insignificant lies that don't negatively affect people, but protect someone from harm. For the sake of safety and privacy, white lies should not only be okay, but should be encouraged. Show them, you know, what can go wrong, like doxing, swatting, online predators. It goes a long way in justifying, you know, small, insignificant white lies. So to get started, it requires encouragement and leading by example. Show your kids how to do it. Start with white lies with strangers, either online or in person. Give out false phone numbers or addresses. If someone asks where you live, give them a nearby location. You don't have to be exact. Create game aliases when creating accounts online. Give false information like incorrect date of births or incorrect addresses. I mean, who's checking? They don't need any information, these companies, to, you know, hop onto a website to play a game. Test the limits. Fill out forms with, you know, incorrect information. I get a lot of packages at home, as an example, with someone else's name or a celebrity's name that I put on Amazon or any other delivery service. I still get the package, and that name doesn't need to go into a database that could get my information breached eventually. I use the concept of burner accounts. These are temporary emails, temporary phone numbers like a Google Voice or a throwaway email address or just something that's not tied to my name. I give those out instead of my real information. I still get the email, the text message, or the package, but no one can abuse that information because they're not really mine. After a few months, I can destroy that information and move on. Realize that we're all going to be hacked one day. We've probably all been in some breaches at this point. The goal is resilience. Resilience is not just how well you can protect yourself, but how well you can come back from a hack. Wouldn't it be great if it didn't matter if someone posted your personal information online because it wasn't true, it was useless, it was made up information? Imagine how silly they would feel doxing you if it wasn't accurate. That's the whole point. We want to be in a situation where we're safe, providing information. So the next time someone asks you for your phone number or email address at, let's say, a grocery store for some points or a discount, or at a clinic or a restaurant, make stuff up if you want to avoid that awkward conversation, or give them alias information. This way you can still take advantage of their offers without compromising your privacy. Remember, the goal is not to disappear, which is actually not that difficult. The challenge is to create a balance to live a life where an online presence is easy and free from the fear of someone abusing that information. My strategies may be unconventional and extreme, but they hold the power to reverse the harmful psychological effects of someone trying to abuse your personal information for personal gain, like sextortion or doxing or stalking or any other online crime. In an era where dependence on online platforms is increasing, our attention spans are decreasing. Our family bonds are weakening, and our attention is decreasing with the people around us. And our feelings of depression intensify because we feel helpless when someone misuses our information to threaten us. By implementing these extreme tactics, like lying, misinformation, using alias accounts, and stalking yourself first before someone else gets a chance to find and expose that information, we can get ahead of the game and reclaim our digital freedom. embracing these methods is not just a choice, but a necessity for forging safer and a more resilient digital future. These unconventional tactics, from the perspective of a white hat hacker, offer hope for a safer digital future where our online footprints no longer expose us to risk, but liberate us. So remember, if you ever get caught lying about your personal information, just tell them a hacker gave you this advice. Thank you and stay safe.